It is hard to believe that just over 5 years ago, I was ripping into the internals of brand new Macs, looking to hodgepodge a fix together such that they wouldn't overheat and cause benchmark scores to plummet. High TDP Intel chips paired with inadequate cooling made for a deadly combo, one that created the worst Macs in decades. But then, in 2020, there was a savior.
Well, today, we are incredibly excited to announce our first step in this transition with our first chip designed specifically for the Mac. And we call it M1.
Apple Silicon was a revelation to what had been deemed an ill-suited form factor. Not only did they keep things thin and light, but they launched with the literal identical MacBook Air chassis that had been on Intel just to prove, hey, not only is this 3.5 times faster, but we don't even need a fan. Oh, and by the way, we didn't touch the battery size at all, but it lasts 50% longer than it did before. Price increase? Nah, same price. Send me a G and we cool. The M1 MacBook Air was a big deal, and the subsequent redesign of the MacBook Pro and M2 MacBook Air righted other wrongs caused by butterfly keyboard sporting laptops of yore, bringing back MagSafe and other I/O, improving displays, speakers, keyboards, and more. Meanwhile, the M1 iMac and iPad Pro proved that no form factor was too small for this masterclass in efficiency. It's not a stretch to say that Apple's current computer lineup is not just Apple's best ever, but perhaps one of the best lineups from any company in history. But be warned, because changes need to happen, and fast, if Apple wants to continue that being true into the future. So let's tackle why the M3 series doesn't quite match up to the physics-defying standards that the M1 set at launch, and how, for the first time ever, real competition is just months away from almost every PC maker imaginable. I've talked a lot about why Apple Silicon has absolutely dominated since launch over the years, but I think it can be summarized to three main drivers behind the M1's incredible success. Number one, ARM64 itself uses significantly more modern ISAs, or instruction set architectures, that don't carry the legacy baggage of x86 that old Apple Intel computers did. We're talking dirty crap, like weakly ordered memory models, a larger number of general purpose registers for parallelizable code, etc. Okay, that's the nerdy one. Number two, Apple's dedicated on-chip hardware blocks, like their video engines for encoding and decoding, their neural engine for AI and machine learning, their matrix coprocessor for other weird stuff I don't remember right now, and unified memory pools. All of those things handled specific tasks vastly more capably than a general compute CPU or GPU could. And then number three, Apple had deep vertical control from hardware to the kernel, to the operating system, to even the applications running on that operating system. Total verticality that helped eliminate cruft and streamline efficiency. All of that work, that had to be paved for M1. So yeah, sure, M2 and M3 have benefited from that work in the years to follow, but they've been iterative. And Apple is now somewhat limited, shall we say, in the same way that everybody else is. Transistor density. Okay, so M1 launched on TSMC's 5-nanometer process, and unlike the 1990s and early 2000s when transistor density and node naming actually correlated with one another, process names today like 5-nanometer, they don't actually mean anything because there's more to chips than logic gates, and hardly any of those features are precisely measured at the market or process size anyway. It's all a scam. Regardless, the M1, not to even mention the massive M1 Max, was just an enormous die. Not just the biggest TSMC 5-nanometer chip produced at the time, but one of the largest ARM chips produced in history. So if they're already doing that, they're maxing out the size, they're making them larger than they've ever been before, what do you do to get a faster chip than the M1, like say the M2? Well, you really have only three options. Number one, you can shrink the size and power consumption of the transistors on the chip so you can add more of them in the same envelope and die size. Number two, you can keep the transistor size the same, but increase the number of them, which makes for a larger die with greater heat and power drain. Or number three, and least ideal, you can keep the transistor size and count the same, but increase the voltage of those transistors in order to push up the chip's clock speed, which creates even more heat and more power drain. M2 did a combination of options one and two, which is pretty unusual. They were able to move to TSMC's refined N5P process, which netted both a 7% performance improvement over N5 and subsequently the M1, while drawing about 15% lower power. But then to speed things up even more, they increased the total number of transistors from 16 billion to 20 billion. But this increase, it doesn't come free. I mean, do some shoddy, not really the full story napkin math, and the data would suggest that the M2 is more power hungry than M1, running hotter and drawing more energy as a total package over its predecessor. Well, that can't be right, right? No, that's not theoretical. We already proved this back when the M2 MacBook Air launched, that the chip was more difficult to keep cool, that it experienced more rapid and more severe performance throttling due to those higher thermals. So then what the heck? Why wasn't this more widely reported? Why wasn't this heat gate? Well, because the M2's performance per watt increased as well, not just the total package consumption. Imagine with me for a second, like a high-performance sports car, okay? The car runs hotter and consumes more fuel when it reaches its top speeds, much like the M2. However, because it's so fast and efficient, it can complete a race around the track much more quickly than a regular car, reducing the total time that it is running at its hottest, most fuel-consumptive state. So while yes, the M2 consumed more total energy than M1 at its peak, that extra compute was able to get tasks done more quickly, reducing the time spent at peak, and therefore maintaining lower energy consumption per task relative to M1. Get it? So I see you. You're sitting there thinking, well, hold on. More performance per unit of energy consumed. That sounds like a win-win, man. What's the problem? To you, I say, man, sand. Sand, man, that's the problem. When the M3 launched last year on TSMC's brand new N3E 3-nanometer process, it was the first chip in the world to do so, and performance expectations from pundits were high. I mean, doing napkin math anew would suggest a 2.8 times increase in transistor density. Huge performance gains. But then the M3 came out and we got a slightly better jump than we did from M1 to M2, and those were even on the same process size. Huh? Well, I guess we've learned our lesson that using napkins for calculations can be as messy as using lipstick for math. That was a good one. Please clap. First of all, TSMC's 3-nanometer node uses transistors that are much physically larger than 3 nanometers. Remember I told you that it was all kind of a marketing lie? Yeah, well, they're closer to 3.5 nanometers. But even that would suggest at least a 2 times density increase. So what's going on? Ah, only the logic density comes close to 2x at 1.7 times increase. SRAM and I/O density barely increases at all. And chips, even magical ones from Apple, contain all of these components. Realistically, there's only about a 1.3 times shrink. The era of massive improvements from one process shrink to the next, that's over. That's done. The shrinks themselves, to make matters worse, are years apart. And even worse than that, each new node is orders of magnitude more expensive than the prior per unit of area. It's estimated that Apple's cost on these new N3E M3 chips is greater, not lesser, than just using a bigger area on an older node. Alas, that would not yield the same efficiency gains we've come to expect from Apple, so they went with this new process. But you might be thinking to yourself, well, more transistors on a bigger chip means more heat. So then what do we do? Well, look, man, we've spent several minutes getting very nerdy and out into the weeds on a lot of stuff that normal people don't care about. They already stopped watching this video 10 seconds in. And at the end of the day, normal people are the ones that buy the vast majority of Apple's products. Sure, the jump from M2 to M3 wasn't as massive as expected, and the jump from M3 to M4 is going to be even smaller. But might I suggest something heretical for a minute? That's okay. The silicon isn't the problem in Apple's lineup any longer. At the same time, might I suggest that it may not perhaps be their everlasting strength. Qualcomm, the folks that make Snapdragon, you know, the chips found in every single Android phone, yeah, they invited me out to their headquarters in San Diego a few weeks ago. And I got to check out the reference design laptops, which basically means they're not real, they're prototypes, but the reference design laptops for their upcoming Snapdragon X Elite SoC, their answer to Apple Silicon. Now, you may recall a year and a half ago, we bought a Microsoft ARM-based Windows dev kit. It utilized the same Microsoft SQ3 chip, which was actually just a rebranded Qualcomm Snapdragon 8cx Gen 3 that had been found in a few quirky, low-power, low-performance Windows laptops. And no offense to the folks at Qualcomm or Microsoft, but this thing sucked. Its performance under ideal conditions was mediocre when compared to M1. And ideal conditions were hard to come by because so much of the Windows experience was wildly unoptimized for ARM, even after a decade following the original release of Windows RT. But that was then. Things change, and we live in the now. Not only has every single native app for Windows made the transition to ARM, but massive quantities of third-party apps have too, including big ones like Google Chrome. Graphics APIs like DirectX, Vulkan, and OpenGL, those are all said to work through mapping layers, and both Microsoft and Qualcomm have made huge efforts over years to ensure a smooth transition from x86 to ARM. Now, they were quick to volunteer that Apple is better at this than everyone. They've done it multiple times already, and they hope that they can be compared to them this summer when the X Elite laptop ships, but they're pretty confident they will, that games will just work, apps will just work, and that's in compatibility mode, Rosetta style, that over the coming months and years, everything's just gonna natively move over to ARM anyway. So you might be wondering, well, what in the heck is the Snapdragon X Elite? What is this chip? Well, they gave me one in this cute little acrylic trading card. It is a bespoke laptop chip. It's not based on a mobile chip, so it's built for laptops, and it's built on TSMC's 4-nanometer process. It comes with a 12 high-performance core CPU, their Adreno GPU platform, and an in-house Hexagon NPU, neural processing unit. Everybody's doing these. It's similar to Apple's Neural Engine. Additionally, the onboard sensing hub houses additional ISPs. You've got onboard Wi-Fi 7 by default, the capability to be paired with up to 64 gigs of LPDDR5 memory, a Snapdragon X65 5G modem, and NVMe storage over PCIe. Look, the specs suggest on this thing that Qualcomm is not messing around. And from the benchmarks that I saw, it consistently placed itself in between the M2 and the M3. Not shabby at all. Now, Apple is still certainly going to have the upper hand with their Pro, Max, and Ultra chips, but this doesn't aim to really compete with those. While OEMs can push the X Elite to run up to 90 watts for an extra performance boost if they want, its reference design consumes just 24 watts peak. Very, very close to the Apple M3. Now, do I think that Qualcomm's going to come out guns blazing with the best laptop chips within the next 3 years? Not really, no. But they're hungry. They've got Microsoft behind them, which is a huge asset, and they've even alluded to the fact that they're not against using heavy-duty GPUs from NVIDIA or AMD in the future. It's not something that's off the table. That is something that Apple seems to have basically zero aspirations for. And just like Apple, Intel, and everybody else, they are really leaning into their NPU for tasks that can use software-defined hardware for maximum efficiency and speed, like AI voice-to-text translation, and a bunch of other random weird stuff, you know, webcams, photo masking. NPUs are cool. And it'll be exciting to see what form factors the Snapdragon X Elite embodies, given its massive power envelope available to OEMs. From notebooks to super power-hungry beasts, the X Elite should fit in those systems. Layer in the fact that this is just their first foray into the X Elite line and that higher performance chips that will compete with the Pro and Max seem to be on the roadmap, and well, we've got competition, baby. So what's Apple to do? Run to TSMC for the next process shrink? Pivot to developing hotter, more consumptive chips in the name of speed? No. And Apple knows that that's not their core competency. Apple Silicon has always been about sufficient performance with extreme efficiency. But physics are a cruel mistress, and many watching this channel don't realize that they're already pushing up against the boundaries that just didn't exist for the M1 series. I still see comments all over the internet that Apple Silicon laptops are dead silent. They never make any noise. Why do they even have fans? They don't even spin. And that's just dead wrong in 2024 with the M3. We edit videos for this YouTube channel on a 14-inch M3 Max MacBook Pro, and the fans run at nearly full tilt nearly all the time. Not even just when exporting. And even with those fans ablaze, spinning full speed ahead, our NLE Premiere Pro struggles to get exports out even close to the time that it can on a 16-inch MacBook Pro. And before you comment as an apologist, no, our machine is not defective. Yes, this happens in other video editors. This is the way things are. They throttle hard. This is not just our unit. Now, is our machine throttling to the point that it's no faster than an M3 Pro 14-inch MacBook Pro? No, it's still faster than that, but It is sometimes slower than an M1 Max, Mac Studio, in a longer export, something the benchmarks would suggest is basically impossible, but it's not, it's true. Look, my point here is that for years and years and years, Apple had the exact same Intel chip SKUs as every other computer maker. There was nothing special about their specific silicon. It was never their selling point. That is until the M1, when that formula got flipped on its head, and Mac owners were, for the first time ever, able to be braggadocious about their computer's speed and efficiency. But Apple is pushing against the technological limits, and others are catching up. So, let's set the silicon aside for a second and just focus on Apple hardware again, okay? I mean, as I see it, the entire MacBook lineup is basically the same. Sure, the Air has a lower quality display and worse speakers than the 14-inch MacBook Pro. And the 15-inch MacBook Air is cheaper and slightly lighter than the 16-inch MacBook Pro. But I mean, come on, man. These machines are closer in design, size, footprint, weight, and feature set than ever before. There is no laptop that truly takes advantage of the form factor provided by Apple Silicon's insane performance per watt. Imagine, with me for a minute, a laptop thinner, smaller, and lighter than the 2015 12-inch MacBook, a computer that still feels impossible today, nearly a decade after its release. Only this time, it doesn't have to be hamstrung by a crappy low-power TDP Intel chip and lousy I/O selection. Would this newfangled machine be slower than an M3 Air? Yeah, sure. But how many people own, heck, a base M1 MacBook Air that have never approached the limits of that chip? I'd venture to say most people. And if your silicon can enable those impressive form factors, do it! On the other end of the spectrum, why not put an M3 Ultra in a 16-inch laptop that's a bit on the hefty side, the style that gamers and creators buy all the time on Team Windows and Team Linux, a chip that just absolutely screams when needed, with the thermal headroom to do it, but while maintaining the excellent idle efficiency offered by Apple's lower power cores. It could be the first gaming laptop with a battery that doesn't die in like 3.5 hours. What I'm getting at is this. When Apple decided to make their own silicon, it was bold. It was a risky move, and it paid off massively. The M1 series will be remembered as some of the greatest computers in history. But it also feels like that was the last time that Apple really took a risk. And I think it's time they stop sitting on their laurels and get back to work before the rest of the industry catches up. What do you think? Let me know in the comments down below. But most importantly, and as always, stay snazzy.